Jesus said this. He said that it is the anointing that breaks the yoke. And let me tell you this, nothing's changed. If you're stuck in something, if you're in a bad place, if you feel spiritually you've become barren, or you, where's the voice of God? You haven't heard the Father. Get into a place of praise and worship, because where the anointing is, there is freedom. Freedom from sin that entangles, freedom from a spirit of depression, and spirit of anxiety. If you want to get to a place of freedom, get into a place of prayer and worship. That anointing still sets free. We glorify the Father. We will see Him come into our situations and make a way where there is none. Where you believe that things are falling apart, worship and pray, and you will see God start putting building blocks together. Amen. So tonight, I've got an awesome sermon, and it's called Salty and Illuminated. Salty and Illuminated. I want to get right into the scripture, and I'm sure you've heard it. If you haven't, then you're going to hear it now, but I'm pretty sure most of us have heard this. Matthew 5, verse 13 to 16, it says the following. It says, "You," that is me and you, "you are the salt for the earth. But if salt loses its taste, how will it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled on by people." Verse 14, "You are the light of the world. A city cannot be hidden when it is located on a hill. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket. Instead, everyone who lights a lamp puts it on a lampstand. Then its light shines on everyone in the house." Finally, verse 16 says, "In the same way, let your light shine in front of people. Then they will see the good that you do and praise your Father in heaven." I want us to look at this passage, this four verses in Matthew 5, a bit more closely. And we're going to start off with verse 13. And it says, as we look at it again, it says, "You," us, "are the salt for the earth. But if salt loses its taste, how will it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled on by people." Listen to these two quotes, okay? They're by Kevin Gary Smith. He is Dr. Kevin Gary Smith is a lecturer at SATS, South African Theological Seminary. And he says the following with regards to this passage. He says, "Of the numerous things to which salt could refer in ancient times, its use as a preservative in food was probably its most basic function. Jesus thus calls his disciples to arrest corruption and prevent moral decay in the world." Secondly, he says, "Believers who fail to arrest corruption become worthless as agents of change." Now, stop there and just listen to what he's saying. He's not saying we are worthless or we become worthless, but what he's saying is very accurate. If believers fail to function salty, if they fail to produce their saltiness, he is saying we become worthless as agents of change and redemption. Christianity may make its peace with the world and avoid persecution, but it is thereby rendered impotent to fulfill its divinely ordained role. So let me explain those two quotes very simply. In ancient times, salt was mostly used as a preservative. They didn't have all the fancy stuff we have today to preserve their foods and many other things. And primarily it was traded and used as a way to preserve food to give it longevity. Okay? Secondly, he's saying that too for believers means that if we, who are supposed to be the salt of the earth, fail to come into a place where we act as a preservative where we are placed, where God puts you and me, if we are not a preservative of holiness, a preservative of seeing change, if we are not a preserving agent of change, Where we are at, we've become worthless where we are at. Then you are just. You get it? So the idea of becoming seeker-sensitive in order to win people kind of fails here. Jesus isn't saying, you are the seeker-sensitive church of the earth. Go forth and make disciples there. He's saying, you are the salt. And what does salt do? It brings about a change in something. Well, I want to show you this. Check it out. Okay? We're going to get to this a bit later. All right. Now, if you've guessed it, this white substance over here, we can get the camera to be on what's happening over here. This will be cool. I was told before church by Devine she will not eat my veggies. And therefore, she will... No, I'm joking. No one's going to eat veggies. Relax. Okay. This is pure water. Well, as pure as you want to call pure water that comes from a tap. Yeah, in South Africa. It's pure water. When I add this to my vegetables, okay, what do I have? I have vegetables in water. How long are these veggies going to remain good? A long time? Not so long. Anybody willing to eat this? Maybe 5 days. Not. Where's your faith, people? Now, this white substance is salt. Now, who will come and drink this? That's a salty mixture. By the way, while I was preparing for this sermon, there was 14,000 uses for salt. A website. If any of you ever get bored, wondering what you can do with salt, that's your place. 14,000 uses for salt. Now, check this out. We add the salt water to the vegetables. Guess what's happening now? These vegetables have become what we term breened. You buy veggies like that in a can. And in this way, it is preserved. Vegetables in breen, which Kelly hates. But besides the point, these veggies can now last a long time instead of a few, maybe a day, maybe two, maybe more. Again, your faith will determine at what point you will no longer eat the veggies in water. I wanted to show you this because what is happening in here is that there was something in here that we term veggies, okay? But I want you to see past the idea of it being vegetables. I want you to understand that you are salt, the salt of the earth. Imagine the veggies are the environment you are in, where God has placed you amongst people. If you are just there, it would be like adding water and expecting a preservative effect to come and arrest, to stop corruption, moral corruption and evil where you are at with water. It wouldn't make the cut. Whereas when we are salty, as Christ wants us to be, and we are added into a situation, not only does it change the outcome of the vegetables or people who you are dealing with, because all of a sudden they are surrounded by saltiness. You see, you add too much salt into a pot of food, you taste it. You don't have enough salt, you taste it. You have just enough, tastes great, right? But salt changes what's happening in the pot. Often we don't add salt into a pot. You immediately know it. You get what I'm saying? Now the problem here is for Christians, we have lost our saltiness. We want to be in here with the veggies because we want to be part of what they are doing. They mustn't know what we are busy with. We want to convert and change them. And do you know what happens? You become one of these veggies without realizing it. You are part of them because you wanted to change them without remaining salty. That is what happens when the Christian wants to mingle without holding the perspective of God's holiness in your life. We cannot elevate one characteristic of God above the other in order to fit in and make us feel fine about it. We hear the love of God proclaimed often in church, and it's wonderful, but where is the justice and righteousness and holiness of God? You cannot elevate the one without the other. I cannot speak of Henny's kindness and not speak of Henny's anger. Sorry, because it's not Henny. You can't speak of Dwain. My wife will tell you guys this. She'll say, this guy you see at church, hey man, there's another one. He lives at home and he throws his underpants on one tile. And he never listens. And the same thing he tells me to do, he doesn't do it. And without this picture of who I am fully, you get an idea of me. And you start putting this idea of me on me and saying, this is Dwain. But let me tell you something, you want to know me? Come live with me for a while. You can't even be my friend and know me, because there's certain things I'm not going to reveal to you. But as you live with me, you'll know me. How can we want to have one aspect of God and claim to know the Father? We can't say just love, 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 and God's like, what about the rest of me? No, God, I don't want the rest of you. I want to detach the rest of you from that part. I want the justice, the just detach, just the love. Oh, Jesus, we love Jesus, love, love, love. It's great, but what about the rest? It's the whole Bible or none of it. You can't tear out pages that are inconvenient. So God calls us to be these agents of change. And if we fail at being salty or fail at representing the Father fully, if we fail at being change agents where we are at, we will merely become part of what's in here. But when we are salty, when we are these agents of preservation, and we become a completely different makeup to what is already happening in the system where we are placed, there's a change. We should be able, I should be able to take you and place you in the wickedest part of the world and expect change. And I'm not talking about you changing into the conforming of where you are at. Come on, church. I should be able to take you and place you in a place like India, where Hinduism and all of those Eastern religions are thriving, and expect to see you in 10 years and you've changed the community. Because you're salty, you're preservative, you change, you stop the corruption. Because you see, the moment these veggies were removed from the freezer, defrosted and put in here, the process of corruption started. You get it? The time bomb started to tick. In other words, at some point, if I left them in here without any treatment, the green was going to get greener. And the white was going to have some spots there, and we might have had some blue and yellow there on veggies that are not blue and yellow. You get it? The time bomb started to tick the moment I removed it from the freezer. But this preserving agent changed the time bomb, and it arrested the time bomb. Ever watch one of those movies? I enjoy it. The last few times I've watched a movie recently, they wait at least till like 6 seconds. It's no longer 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 1 and a half. Deet! Stopped it. And everyone's like, wow, that guy stopped it just in time. Wow. I see these days people are like, come on, that's gotten old and dead now. Let's stop it at like 10 seconds. This is what happens when we do this, when we are change agents. The time bomb ticks, tick, 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 tick. It's going to decay. It's going to fall apart. Everything is morally corrupt. Tick, 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 poof. And in that moment, God stops the clock of moral decay and he shifts it back because you are present in a situation that would otherwise fall apart. Often I've heard this, thanks Dion, where Christianity is in a place where they say to you, man, you better not get part of the world. The world will destroy you. Check this out. In the next part of the scripture, we check verse 14 and it says, you are the what? The light of the world. A city cannot be hidden when it is located on a hill. Now I need Barry's help. And I want two. I'm going to ask Henny. Come, man. You can help me. Martin, you come. Okay, we're going to use two guys and we're going to show you something. Brother, I need you to wield awesomely the light. Wield the light. And let's kill all other lights in this place. Can we get the projectors down? Okay. We're just going to kick out those projectors for us and then we're going to check this out. So here we go again. It says, you are the light of the world. A city cannot be hidden when it is located on a hill. Listen to this, church. As children of light, we have various functions. We are called to enlighten those who are in darkness as to salvation. Guess what? When you're an unbeliever, guess where you're at? Where you're sitting right now. Guess who's wielding the light? The answer to your problem, salvation. Those who are light bearers for the Father. Those that have been enlightened by God. For our illustration, it is Martin and Henny and Dwain here in front of you holding light. And I'm called to bring salvation to you who are in darkness. Listen to this. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 4 to 6. It says, the God of this world has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. As a result, they don't see the light of the good news about Christ's glory. It is Christ who is God's image. Verse 5, our message is not about ourselves, unless you were confused. It is about Jesus Christ as the Lord. We are your servants for his sake. Finally, verse 6 says, we are his servants because the same God who said that light should shine out of darkness has given us believers light. For that reason, we bring to light the knowledge about God's glory, which he shines from Christ's face. Come on, church. You want people to come to Christ without you? It's impossible. Because you are it. You are the light. And without the light guiding someone to Jesus Christ, to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, how will they see? You see, here we have two people that are bearing light this evening with me. And if I wanted Werner to get to from a point A to point B in total darkness, it will be one heck of a struggle. But if I ask Henny, who has light, to take the hand of Werner and say, come brother, I need you to follow me. I'm taking you from point A to B. All of a sudden, Werner can see where he's going because someone has light and he is illuminating him towards Jesus. But unfortunately, the church has stopped doing that because what if Werner takes my light and puts out my light? Well, are you bearing the light of God in you? Because how can it be removed from you? Secondly, we are called to illuminate wickedness Exposing evil for what it is. Evil hasn't stopped being evil, church. Hello. Evil still comes into lives and it wrecks it. Come on. We were talking about moral decay and all of that, but let me tell you something very practical. In my house, we have a sickness, and it's called closing all doors and windows. And Kelly and Olivia like having baths. And when they have their baths, they like it hot. And when they do it hot, the whole house steams. Guess what happens in our house? It's moldy. Ew. There are spots in my house where mold loves to grow. And if I don't arrest the corruption quickly, guess what happens to that spot that used to be a mere size of my thumb? It becomes the size of my hand and then the size of my body. And then I'm like negotiating with the mold. Come on, brother. How can we have a 50? You can get Olivia's room. Leave the rest of the house. Because it's gone that far. If I don't arrest evil as I see it manifest in my life, before I know it, I am a slave to sin once more. And then I'm justifying it by the grace of God. And yes, God says when sin abounds, grace abounds more. But then he says, shall we then sin because of God's grace? Far be it, he says. Yet the church says, it's fine. Let moral decay corrupt us, for God's grace is sufficient. We can only outrun the consequences for sin so long. You don't like what I'm saying? It doesn't really matter. It doesn't stop being the truth. How can I explain it simply? Well, I believe that you shouldn't smoke. I really do. And the reason behind that is not for me so sore that you'll burn in hell. But there's a reason the packet says you could get cancer. Right? Now listen to me. There is a place where you can get. Ask me, because I've lost 2 grandfathers to lung cancer. Where the packet's warning and the voice of God saying, please stop. Please stop. Has come this far. This far. And you are here. And you have outrun the voice of warning. And all of a sudden you receive something that you didn't need to receive if you were obedient. Is God giving me cancer? No. I have created something for myself based on consequences. Why are we not speaking about this in church? Let me tell you this. If my dad looked at me running towards a car and he did not stop me because he didn't want to spoil my fun, he'd be a bad dad. They're playing so nicely, man. I know. Maybe the car will miss him. I would expect my daddy to stop me, to punch me, to run me over if he has to. But he doesn't want me to die. Why don't we want God to stop the fun if it means preserving our lives? It's not about not smoking. It's about God wanting the best for you. Why do you want second best? Smoking is something we highlight, but let me tell you something. If your biggest issue is eating and you're eating yourself to death, don't tell me, at least I don't smoke. If you are drinking yourself to death, but at least you don't eat and you don't smoke, don't tell me I eat so healthily and I don't smoke, but yeah, man, I can polish a bottle of vodka. And there are so many sins that is entangling the church. Sexual sin. Why does Paul warn against stuff like that? Does he say, oh, we're going to burn in hell? He says these things for us. Why? Because Paul wants you to realize you can never live in the fullness if you tolerate wickedness. And now, I'm going to ask Martin to pick out anybody. And I'm going to ask Henny to kill his light. And I'm going to kill my light. And I want Martin to show someone, illuminate them. grab this illuminator. And this is the light of God. Now listen, Ephesians 5 verse 8 to 14 says, once you lived in the dark, but now the Lord has filled you with the light. Live as children who have light. Light produces everything that is good, that has God's approval, and that is true. Determine which things please the Lord. Have nothing to do with the useless works that darkness produces. Instead, expose them for what they are. Expose them. How? How do I expose them? The light of God, His word, which is a lamp unto my feet, is so clear, and it helps me to expose, show clearly. Oh, I don't understand this, God, but His word explains it so clearly. No, but it must mean something else because this feels so good. His word hasn't changed. He still says it to us. These things destroy, and through the light of the word, He illuminates that which is otherwise in darkness and shows us first and foremost, me and you, in our own lives. See, we are the light of the world, but before we can be the light to the world, we have to be the light in ourselves to see clearly what is a hindrance. Listen. It is shameful, verse 12. It is shameful to talk about what some people do in secret. Light, however, exposes the true character of everything. Nothing will remain in darkness. Hear me, church. Nothing will remain in darkness. Unfortunately, God loves you too much to leave you in your secret sin. And you can plead with Him saying, Father, no, you know what? Just leave me with this. This is my little thing, man. There is a place where His voice of stop, stop, stop before. I don't want you to reach the consequences. I think of someone like Kirk Franklin who was addicted to pornography. And God spoke to him, clearly, stop this, stop this. And Kirk went on with it. And there was a place where he could no longer maintain ministry and living in the public eye as a Christian. And his secret sin. There was a place where he no longer could represent God in His fullness without people starting to ask questions. And God, for His name's sake, drew the line. And at some point, Kirk Franklin came out and said, church, this is what's been happening. And he had to start a process of restoration. Get it though, there is restoration. But there's a place where the Father says, stop, stop, stop. And we outrun the consequences because it's so good. And then when the consequences are felt, we say, God, where are you? Why didn't you do this? God was busy warning you all the time to stop because He loves you. And you said, no, thank you. And He says, then there will be consequences. But what about His grace? It is His love and grace that doesn't let you run into the road. So God the Father will let you play with your friends, kick the ball around. He'll even let you play close to the highway. But if He sees you're going to head into that highway and be run over, He will rather stop you at any cost, even if it means scraping your knee. But we run away. Don't want to hear it, God. It's too good. This is right. This is right. Why is the voice of God saying to you it's wrong? If it's so right, why do you have to drown out the Holy Spirit? Listen to this. Light exposes, verse 13, the true character of everything, and then it finishes. It says, because light, in verse 14, makes everything easy to see. That is why it says, wake up, sleeper. Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. With the warning is always restoration. God doesn't warn so He can destroy. He warns because He wants to restore. He wants you to live in fullness. Stop just living in the way you're living and being content with it. pray and say, Father, I want your fullness. And then allow him to do that. Finally, what is the implication of light? Finally, we say in the above passage, in light of the above passage, we not merely expose darkness, because that really is kind of stupid. Just saying, look, darkness is exposed. Okay, what about what comes after? Well, what does come after? We are to expose darkness to lead to light. You cannot merely go to someone and say, I see your sin. Do you have an answer? Do you have a way for them to get out of that sin? Are you prepared to walk a road? No. Okay, put away your lamp. Because you are not called to just show everyone, look what you're doing wrong. Look what you're doing wrong. Look what you're doing wrong. You're called to say, Father, expose. Now let us restore. There has to be restoration when there has been illumination. Otherwise, we only expose sin and leave people in their sin. We leave people in the corruption, and we are no longer salty. Finally, we can get all the lights back on in the church. Thanks, guys. Sweet. Finally, we look at Matthew 5, verse 15 and 16 together. It says, no one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket. Instead, everyone who lights a lamp puts it on a lampstand. Then its light shines on everything in the house, on everyone in the house. Verse 16 says, in the same way, let your light shine in front. I like it. In front of people. Not behind them, not in a way they don't see, in front of them. Why? Then they will see the good that you do and praise you. No. They will see the good that you do and they will give glory to your Father who is in heaven. God instills us with his marvelous light with the purpose that it might shine. The question is, where is light most needed? Anybody want to take a guess? Do you need light in light? This is cool, I know. Light. But we kind of have light, right? Where is light most needed? In darkness. Failing to shine in darkness defeats the purpose for which God has instilled us with light. He's instilled us with his marvelous light to go and shine in the darkest places, being children bearing his light. He wants us to go and change where he puts us. Not to hang out with a bunch of Christians and feel good about being Christians. There's a time and a place for being Christians and having a Christian braai and having fun. Then there's a time to put yourself away, crucify the flesh, and go sometimes where you don't really want to go, where you don't feel comfortable, to shine his marvelous light. How else will darkness be illuminated? A while ago when we were fasting this, at the beginning of the year, we were watching a movie called The Holy Spirit. And in that movie, they were interviewing ex-member of Korn, Brian Welch. If you know Brian Welch, he's an odd-looking guy. For some of us, he's a cool-looking guy, as you want. But Brian was told by God to remove himself completely from Korn, to eject himself from the situation, to not be on the scene, get out of there. The drugs were destroying him. Everything was destroying him. The sex addiction, drug addiction, alcohol addiction, everything was just too much. Get out. Right? And then God started a process with Brian. But then God did something weird. He said, Brian, it's time to go back. Back to Korn? Yes, I want you to go in the darkest dark and shine my marvelous light. And we saw on the DVD how before concerts, they have guys that have t-shirts that say, I hate God, I'm an atheist, praying for their healing and seeing them healed there and then. Guess what? The guy with the I hate God t-shirt, he's not coming to church. Maybe he would know. I really don't think he's coming to church. But he's going to a Korn concert. And God says, my light shines in the darkest place. Why is our God so small? that we believe if I am sent to a place like that, the darkness will drown out the light. I better not go. And the second part is, don't go if you're not sent. Don't be stupid. I'm going to Gotti's tomorrow. Gotta go be the light. And when you get there, I've become the darkest dark. Why? Because I wasn't sent. If I am sent, then I will be there with a mandate and the Father will anoint me to do what he wants me to do. But if he sends you, even if it is the darkest dark, if I'm going with his mission, his mandate, I believe there's purpose. And I want to go. And I want to see his light shine. We saw that earlier this year in Lesotho. It was the first time I was on an outreach where we were met with some hostility. Some of the guys there didn't like that we were there, and they would stand outside the tents with, I don't know what you call it in English, a knopkiri. And they would intimidate all the people that were there to proclaim the gospel. But God, why? We're proclaiming your good news. Protect us. God says, shine my light in the darkest place. So when the guy comes and wants to hit you with his kiri thing, smile at him. And one of those guys, I loved it. One of those very guys ended up being the final night's illustration guinea pig. And what happened? God just loved him. And then he washed his feet, gave him new socks to put on, prayed a blessing over his life. Guess what? He didn't feel like hitting any with a knopkiri. He was floored because light drowns out darkness every single time. What the devil purposes for evil, God uses, and his marvelous light shines at the most beautiful thing. In a moment that a day or two ago looked like someone's going to punch us, turned into the same guy that was going to be the punchee. It's glorifying God, because how can this God love me so much? His light shines out darkness. So I can attest to how in the darkest places that we perceive, God uses us the most mightily. Why? Because he sends us. And we were sent there. God sent us to Lesotho and we had the backing of God. So in that way, we could be there and know, man, whatever goes down, we're here for his purpose. I trust him. And his light shines out darkness again and again and again. How else will the world be illuminated? See, what churches are doing today is, I go to the Dutch Reformed and I say, become Chrisma Fellowship Church. Come to us. So what I'm doing is, I'm taking this light and you have your light. And now we have a light party. Woo, church, we're having church. Let's all have our lights together and have one big light church. Yeah. And I'm trying to find more people that are like-minded with me. Let's go church, 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 church. And yet around me, people remain in darkness. God is not calling, and he hasn't called ever, churches to poach each other's people. Because we have the truth and you don't. We're Pentecostal and you're dead. Like, that's the heart of God. Come on. God is calling us to bring the lost sheep to the shepherd. Not the sheep that looks different than you. It's a sheep. He's class cop. He's already in the family. It's like in our house when I was growing up. I have a sister and a brother, and every single one of us is very, very different. I have a perfectionist sister that must have everything in place. And then I have a brother that's, he's like my dad. He's like a mirror image of, and then we have me. Yeah. I asked my sister one day, why don't you do something eccentric? She says, I have you as a brother. I was like, there, you're sharp today. Well done. We're different even in our households. Can we be different in church? And can we put our focus and effort to illuminating the lost that are in darkness, where Paul calls us to show them the light? Instead of focusing our efforts saying, I'm sure my light shines brighter than yours. Therefore, come to my church, then you can get one of these big lamps. Our lamps are cooler. No. We are called to go be light in darkness. To summarize this message, God wants to use you and He wants to use me to change the makeup of our environment and to preserve it from evil corruption. Illustration one. He wants us to be in where we are placed, but not to conform, but change. To bring His holiness and exalt His name where we are placed. We don't have to run away because maybe they'll get me. No, you have the Spirit of the living God living inside of you. You'll be okay. Go be who God called you to be, where He's placed you. Secondly, God wants to illuminate men to salvation. He wants to expose evil in my life first, and then I'm able to show others. There's a scripture I was looking at in Romans 2 as I was preparing, where Paul calls out the Jews and he says to them, you want to call someone out on adultery, yet you commit adultery. And the point of it is, I cannot call someone out on their sin if I myself are still busy with the same stuff. So at some point, God wants to free me and I need to be honest of where I'm at so that the Father can free me. But I have the option of saying to the Father, I don't want to hear this. It will inconvenience my life where I'm at now. I enjoy this too much. This is who I am. This is what I'm going to do. What? And you can do that. Will you be cut off from the Father? I don't believe so, because we are saved by grace through faith. But when the consequences catch up to your actions, you shouldn't be asking what happened now. Church, please hear my heart. I'm not here to condemn anyone about anything. But I am honest when I say to you, there is a place where our consequences will catch up. If we live a certain way, it will catch up. There is just that. It's a reality. When we were in America, there was an ad that came on TV. Well, quite a few of them, and they were always something like this. Claritin for hay fever, what do they call allergies? Claritin for allergies. It can help you live a quality life, blah, 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 and then it comes. Claritin can cause blindness, it can cause numbness, it can cause paralysis, and they have to say every single thing on the ad that can happen to you if you drink this medication, but it will make you feel better. And the first time I heard that, I'm like, Kelly, you want to go drink that? Huh? You want one of those pills? The one that can make you blind, lame, dumb. you're going to sleep well. You might not wake up, but you'll have a good sleep. Come on. And sometimes that's where we are at. God is so clear. This is going to happen. Don't do it. But it feels good, God. Okay? I might get away with it and I might never ever be that person that's going to be blind. But one of those side effects will get me. They always do. That's why they put them in there so you don't go back and sue them. And they do sue a lot. The point is, we can live in a way where we choose to not want to be illuminated to where we are at. But don't expect God to use you in the fullness of what He has for you. God will never send someone that has not defeated sexual sin to work with prostitutes. Come on. But someone who has escaped that and have been freed from that, who better to work with them? As we have seen in that movie Nefarious in the last Bible school night, how God takes the sex trafficker, changes his whole life, and sends him back to sex trafficking to free people. Why? Because He knows exactly how they work. But can God use him while he's still a sex trafficker? No, because you'll send him to people and you'll traffic them. Has to free him first. So yeah, God can use you. But there's a place he's not going to use you, because greater good will outweigh what you want. God will not use you in a place where you haven't got freedom. And just in case, you destroy. Why? Because he loves and his grace and his mercy. It's a dad. It's a good dad. Just remember that illustration. Kid running into the road. Nah, I don't want to stop the fun. Really? Really? No. You stop that fun at any cost. Because we are here to preserve lives. Finally, as we expose evil in ourselves and we receive freedom in areas, God uses us to do the same for others, to set them free, to show them the darkness but lead them to righteousness. Restoration follows illumination. If I show someone something, this in your life, God wants you to be free from it. I have to journey for restoration. I can't just show them, this is wrong, see you. No, we are agents of change. Preservers. Finally, we must shine in darkness, go into the world. We should not hide away. You're not called to come to Christ and hide. That's called the escapist theology, where I come to Christ and then I have to hide. I have to be set apart. Peter says that we are a royal priesthood, set apart. All of a sudden, you're a hermit on a mountain. No friends. I'm set apart. You've lost your saltiness and you are no longer the light of the world. Come on. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for a word that is God ordained into the lives of your people. I thank you that you are depositing into us something because you have greatness in store for people sitting here. You want to use people like never before to see one final shift in this world. Father, I believe that people will hear tonight, that they will understand that they are placed somewhere to make a difference, that they will understand that the Father loves them and that he wants to change within them certain things that might be so good, they enjoy it so much and they want to still do it so much and they continue to justify it, but the Father will not relent because he wants us free. My Jesus paid to set us free from it all. Scripture is clear, who the Son has set free is free indeed. Stand therefore in your freedom and do not again be bondaged. Father, I thank you that tonight you reawaken in us a desire for holiness. To not exalt one part of you, but to say all of you, Father. We want all of you. Let us be obedient to your voice. Holy Spirit, I pray that tonight you are speaking to your children, that you will not relent, that you will continue. Do so in the most strangest way, Father, because I believe that some of us are in a place where the consequences are catching up. We are trying to outrun it, and we cannot do it any longer. Father, I pray that before everything falls apart and the consequences are felt in full force, let us be obedient and God will relent. Father, I pray that we will not be as Israel was, as you continuously warned with the prophets. And often we don't realize that so long went past, you would warn, they would repent, as Nineveh repented, Father. 100 years later, they are caught again, and then the consequences are felt. 100 years before, when Jonah got to them, they relented. They repented before you, and you did not send calamity. 100 years later, they did not repent, Father. Let us not be those who turn a deaf ear. Just because once we repented, and now we have repented for all. There must be a continuous breaking of the heart where we say, Father, I know. I want to live holy. I want to be good before you. Create in us, as the psalmist says, create in me a pure heart, O God, that I will not sin against you. Father, let us not start to believe some watered down message of grace that says, I'll just do whatever I want because I can. Let us seek to live holy because we love you. Let us stop this nonsense of calling the grace of God some license to sin so that we can just keep doing what we're doing. But let us be people that are consecrated once more. Not for condemnation, Father, but because of love. That you want us to live in the fullness of you. Thank you that we are saved eternally, Father, and that our salvation is not removed from us. We are eternally secure. But Father, I will not use eternal security as a license to sin against you. I did not follow you to get out of hell free card. I did not start following you because I didn't want to burn in hell. I started following you because it was your goodness that led me to repentance. And it is your love that sustains me in your grace. I seek you, Father, and I want to live for you. Church, join me in this journey. Let us not become hard-hearted as the Pharisees were and start proclaiming ourselves righteous. Let us remember it is the righteousness of Christ that justifies. And that his new nature dwells within us now, enabling us to live holy. To start becoming like Christ. Let us not set up camp next to salvation and say, I made it, this is it, I'm not moving one step further. Let us journey in sanctification so that God can use us increasingly. Let us journey in sanctification so that we can become more like Jesus. Father, we want to see this world changed, and we're not going to see it changed with some half-hearted Christianity. We're going to see it changed because the sons and daughters are standing up to be counted. They are tired of mediocrity. They are tired of living in some cheap grace idea. They are seeking the heart of God. And if God wants me to stop doing this, I will stop. Because I want to live in his fullness. If God wants me to go left, I'll go left. If he says go right, I'll go right. If he says jump, then I'll jump. If he says dance, then I'll dance. If he says shout, then I'll shout. But for him, I'll do anything. Surely I can let sin go. Surely I can let an entanglement go that is destroying me to see him come in my life and use me to the full. Father, your fullness come in our life now in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, minister to us. We understand sanctification is a journey. But Father, don't allow us to stagnate. If you freed us from this, don't let us go back to it. Help us to remain free and a journey to receive our next freedoms. Understand that God will come and for one person, he will remove something instantly. But for you, it could be a journey. Remain on the journey. Don't become a death to the voice of God in your life saying, stop, stop, stop. Say, no thanks. Then the consequence will come. But if we are faithful to God, he's faithful to us and he will journey with us. And he will not leave us in our sin if we are there saying, God, this is a struggle, help me. But if we become content, fine then. The consequence will be there. It's just the way it is. The wages of sin are still death. If we continue in sin, it will kill us. Father will save you because you are eternally secure. But do you want second best? Or do you want to be a light to the world? Father, I pray that these people sitting here tonight are here because you have preordained them to hear this word, because they are change agents. They are the light of the world. You will use them, Father, because they will be obedient to your voice. Your word says obedience is better than sacrifice. We will be obedient. We will be known as people of obedience. Radical obedience to the voice of God. Surely if God calls me out on sin, I will listen. If I am to be radically obedient, how can God send me to the most wicked parts of the earth if I am struggling with this sin that is so minute in comparison with where he wants to use me? God wants us to be free first. I just feel tonight as every eye is closed, where you are at, just stand up if you feel that way, if you feel like this is a struggle, whatever it is. No one's going to say nothing to you about what it is. Tell me your sin. If you are in a struggle with something, doesn't even have to be sin. If you've come to a place where God has become almost theoretical to you, and you're here in church, but I just want to cover all bases, and the relationship has grown cold, stand up. If you feel like sin is entangling you, stand up. If you are chasing after other things than God, stand up. Because we're going to pray now, and we're going to ask God to intervene supernaturally again. Because I believe His grace is still available. That He's still there to come and remove instantly from us because of His great love. And I believe that God is using tonight as a crossroads for people, saying, you've journeyed, there will be a consequence, but listen tonight, there's a warning here for you. And if you listen, I will come once more supernaturally, and I will help you. If you do not listen to me, then I cannot protect you from the consequences you so desire. But if you listen to my voice, says the Lord, I will restore you. I will take you once more and remove you from that sin that is entangling you. I'll remove you from this pursuit of wealth and greed and pride in your life. I will come once more as I did before, supernaturally. But don't not heed this warning. And as every eye remains closed, don't bother looking around. Be busy with God yourself. Because I guarantee you there's something in every one of us that is busy with nonsense. That we are not fully chasing after God to the fullness that He wants. Don't bother looking at Sunny and Kwesi and whoever. Be busy with the Father. And if that is you, just stand up where you are. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Don't bother looking around. Father, as every person that has decided tonight to say, I want intervention, they stood up. Father, they stood up with boldness. They decided, Father, that they will make a stand. That they want to be illuminated first before they go and illuminate anybody else. And tonight, Father, I thank you that you come and you illuminate us once more. You set us on fire once more. You remove supernaturally once more that is entangling us. Father, I thank you for your word that says, now that you have been freed, don't go back. What God removes supernaturally, don't get entangled again, because next time you might have to fight it yourself. Let the Lord free you and then stay free. Don't fall back into it. Father, I pray in Jesus' name, as every person is standing in this place, let you supernaturally intervene in their lives. Remove from them these things that are entangling them. They are standing obediently before you, Father, crying out, saying, help me, God. Thank you, Lord, that you will not have a deaf ear to these cries of your children, saying, intervene in my life, Father. I want to live fully for you. I want to live wholly for you. I don't want second best. I want to be consecrated as a royal priest to the holy nation, as the word declares so. I want to be a light that shines in the darkness. I want to be used by you for your name's sake. I don't want to just make it to heaven. I'm following after the fullness of you, God. Lord, I pray that those hearts will be honored this evening. Holy Spirit, thank you that they will just receive now there where they are at. They will just know that you are touching them, Father. Whether it be in a manifestation of heat, fire, Father, that they can feel tangibly that they are being touched by God. Whether it be a peace on their hearts where they know God is busy with me. Whether it be a voice of God speaking to them. I just pray, Lord, that you give them assurance there they're at, where they are at, that they stood up to be counted and you saw their hearts, and you are honoring your word this evening, that you spoken, Father, that you will come and set them free. I thank you, Father, that before anybody in this place has to stand, I, Dwain Stewart, stands before all of them and declares, I as well, I struggle, Father. I struggle with many things. Sin, Father. Anger, Father. With self-doubt, Father. Sadness, Father. Thank you that in my life I can declare before people unashamed, because I am not ashamed of the gospel. That these are things that I struggle with. And before anybody else has to declare it, Father, I declare it before them. I am a sinner that struggles and I want to be free. I want to live in your fullness. I want to be on fire again. I pray, Lord, that you honor us as we stand before you in obedience. Thank you for that tangible feel, that tangible presence that assures us that you have set us free, that assures us you are busy with us, that we know you are so real and you are here. You are part of our restoration and part of what you are doing in our lives right now, Father. Thank you that you come and give us that assurance. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We just receive this evening. Don't intellectually fight it. Just submit to God and let God do what he wants to do in your life. Oh, Father, I thank you. Just receive this evening. Just receive from you. You unravel me with a melody. And Father, I declare your word as we end this service. Because your word is true. Yesterday, today, and forever, your word will stand. And tonight, who has stood up in this place, who has made a bold statement to say, I want to be free. Father, I thank you for your promise that says, who the Son has set free is free indeed. Hear me. Make it your own in any way you can. That you who have stood up tonight do not be entangled again by the same things. Every single time you remind yourself, who the Son has set free is free indeed. I will stand in my freedom. Who the Son has set free is free indeed. I will stand in my freedom. Thank you, Jesus. Assurance, assurance. We just receive it this evening. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.